All right, guys, just a quick update on our international car show. As of now, we have about 1,000 submissions. So guys, thank you very, very much for letting us see all of your rides. Voting will start in about a week, and we'll be giving away about $10,000 worth of prizes. So you guys wanna keep coming back and checking it out. A couple things I do wanna say is, if you have more than one project, don't do them in the same video, split them up, and really make sure that you pick the proper category for your project. Mad props, as anything with a propeller, and there are cars in there, you're not gonna win that category. So definitely choose your judges, and you wanna put some good effort into it. Some current videos and current pictures, so we know where you're at. Those categories, there's 14 judges judging them, so your project does fit in one or two of them at least. Just make sure that they're the right ones. And since there's about a week left of submitting your rides, we thought, you know what? Let's just add another category, just because we're the ones running the show and we can do that. So we'll have more details about it after the video. Stick around to figure out how you can also win $10,000 worth of prizes. It's kind of cool. Here we go. So another Audi episode. Now that we've rebuilt everything on the inside and the bottom of the car, and we feel pretty good about it. We took it to the track and it's holding together pretty good. You know, we thought it kind of only deserves a new wrap on the outside. So we got Ian here. Ian, you do wraps?
I do wraps. I've been doing it for 4 years now.
If Ian could wrap this hunk of junk with all of our different contours and like, there's like rust, I'm actually really excited to see what's underneath this car, because I can't remember it in the scrapyard, but I think there's like big chunks of paint missing.
Bondo here.
I knocked a chunk out of that fender. I added a whole bunch of rivets there.
No, it'll be exciting. I know it's a little bit of a different project from my usual stuff.
This one we got done in town, and we kind of rushed it. I liked the wrap, but Aaron never really did. And it's actually really difficult to find somebody who can design a wrap and install it. Like, it's either either or.
Over the 4 years I've been doing this, like, a lot of people focus on, you know, I do personal cars or I do corporate wrap, whatever the case is, but they won't have a designer, or, you know, they'll only focus on one type of vehicle.
Okay.
But I figured, you know, it's a lot more fun to do projects like this where it's something unusual. I get to design it, be creative, because I went to OCAD for...
he's not gonna say it's fun by the time we're done.
I haven't worked on a car of this, like, kind of vintage. So it was a challenge to build.
You're a Group B?
Oh, yes, 100%.
There we go. 100%. So we got the right guy. Here we go.
RS2 is a very sought after car in Europe and all over the world. It makes a lot of jam.
I recognize those.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I know our turbos didn't need a rebuild, but you thought you could upgrade them a little bit anyway?
They need a rebuild, a little one.
We're gonna see how this works out, because I've never done this before.
All right, so that is the fiberglass bumper. It turned out really, really well. So Aaron said that the scoops are too small, so I made them bigger. The reason I went to here originally is because that is the top of my wheel well. I didn't want to start messing with that structural integrity of that stuff. But it looks bigger. Like, I can almost stick my, well, I can stick my fist in there now. But it could be bigger. So I started banging on this, bent that over a little bit. And then I thought, you know what? It would be a lot better if I just cut all of that out. So I took this piece of aluminum, just bent it up. And if I stick that in there, in the door, that would look kind of sick, actually. And it doesn't cut out too much. So that's what I'm gonna do. I'm just gonna cut a lot more out. And then that would, before we get a wrap put on, that would be wonderful. That is gonna be wonderful. I'm gonna do it. And I'm gonna make this part of the door so that'll swing in there. This will stick out past the door here. That'll be like that. But when I close, that would line up nicely like that. Right on, let's do it. Let's cut some holes, here we go.
is. Hole's much bigger now. And this should create a little bit of negative pressure as the air is coming around. It'll get sucked in because it's going down, kind of like the opposite of a wing. And then it'll get put in there. Keep in mind that this is not a cooler. There will be a negative pressure in there because the turbos will be sucking from there. I'll clean this up a little bit on the inside afterwards. But that's it's not bad. I kind of like that. Now we got to do the other half. And I kind of ruined the wrap, so I think we might have to put a whole new wrap on it. So this wing we found on Kijiji, which is actually meant for a Mustang, a newer style Mustang. I think it attaches to this somehow, and it actually is supposed to come out of the back because the Mustang kind of leans that way. It comes out of the back and goes up, and because our car is so long, it doesn't make sense coming out of the trunk and going over top. It looks kind of goofy. So we decided to do this instead. We got aluminum brackets that go right through this. So it's actually a piece of intercooling piping that I had Vince weld. And it actually pivots on this. So we can change the angle if we want, top and bottom. We got a pin going through the top. And I have to get Vince to cap these properly. But we're able to rotate it and then bolt it into a different spot. So I only bolted it in one spot. Once we start hitting the track more and we can do some ribbons and try to figure out where the airflow is, we can change the angle. We can go up, but up goes back, forward goes down. Try to figure out where the roof line is nicely. And then because having a spoiler or a wing on a trunk that flops around doesn't make any sense, what we did was make this frame out of aluminum we found at the scrapyard, and then that actually goes right down to the frame runners and is bolted down to that, so it's super solid. The issue is now we can't take our trunk lid off really easy, and we need to make a filler neck for our fuel tank. But one thing at a time. Here we go. Kind of threaded in, and then nuts on top yet. So it is carbon fiber. Now, we don't know whether we're going to wrap that or not. Ian's thinking he might wrap it. I cut all the webbing out, lighten this up.
Oh, wow.
And then because I waited a bunch of times. So the trunk lid was surprisingly heavy. I knocked like 8 pounds off the trunk lid. And then the spoiler weighs like 20 pounds or something. I forget now.
Oh, only 11 pounds.
And I think I took like 8 pounds off. It was almost 20 pounds. And then, so the spoiler weighs 20 pounds, 240. 20 pounds on the back, which we keep taking more and more weight off the front and putting it on the back. We should be very close to 50-50. The Audi needs a spoiler. So wait. Aerodynamics.
So we've been working on this design for about 3 weeks now. I'm super excited to get started with it. It's very different than what I've done in the past on personal vehicles or corporate vehicles, given like the age of the car, the era that it was made. Just for example, so these bumpers, right? There's really hard 90 degree of curves on it, whereas a lot of the cars I've done in the past, you know, it's nice, smooth, all one piece. So it's gonna be interesting. You know, very different than what I'm used to, and we'll see what we can make happen with it. Doing these car wraps, like if you have any sort of paint or Bondo or something like that underneath, the wrap can sometimes grab, you know, that loose paint, loose surface, and peel it off. So when you're taking wraps off, you have to be super careful with it. Newer cars obviously usually have very, very good paint. There's no imperfections underneath, so you don't have to worry too much on a new car. But when you're doing something that's not straight from the showroom, you usually have to be very careful with it.
It was
new 30 years ago.
It was new 30 years ago, exactly. So you just gotta take it small pieces, just make sure you don't move too quick on it, and then you should be okay.
So we got most of the wrap off the car already. It was a lot harder than I had initially thought it would be. But because we had to remove the old wrap, there's gonna be a lot of like glue residue and whatnot. So just going over it with isopropyl, 99% isopropyl, just to clear off the glue. So yeah, you can see that some paint was taken up when I pulled off the wrap. So whoever wrapped it beforehand used adhesive promoter. So that helps on really tight corners and makes it so that, you know, lasts longer. Doesn't fail quite as often, but problem is when you have paint that isn't absolutely perfect, when you first go to wrap it, it can occasionally, you know, pull up paint. It's not the best for the paint. So we're just going over it, cleaning off all the extra glue, making sure that the panels have no dust or anything on it, so that when we actually go to do the rest of the wrap, it's nice and flat, no particles underneath, and yeah, make it look perfect. Okay, so when we're doing wraps on vehicles that have either super aggressive curves to them, indents to them, or something that has like, you know, a little bit of rough paint, there's this product called adhesive promoter, and it's a 3M adhesive promoter. Good thing about this stuff is that when you have something like this surface, the vinyl's not gonna stick to it very well, right? So you wanna make it a lot easier for it. What we do is take a little paintbrush. You don't have to use a lot, but we just put a little bit along the edges where there's a chance that the vinyl is not going to stick very well. So down here, vinyl just like, it will not stick to it, and that'll come off very quickly. So what we're going to do is we're going to cover this, basically this entire thing with it, and that'll make it so that the vinyl can actually, won't just peel up here. Plus this is also going to be windward facing. So when you're have an edge that's in the stream of the air, there's a good chance that it's going to take a lot of abuse and it'll pop up. So you cover this, and then that kind of ensures that it doesn't lift.
Okay, so we threw a few more curveballs at Ian. We didn't tell him about this big vent, which looked okay at first, but then it was starting to bubble out a little bit, like it pulling.
Yeah.
Can't stretch it enough.
So what we did is, I'll actually show you. So this is because it's such an aggressive curve there. We tried to like bridge this piece across there and then push it in. But when you heat the vinyl, you can only get maybe like 10% stretch out of it before it starts getting a little bit iffy. So we tried putting it in there, and it just immediately started lifting.
Okay, so you're just gonna print another piece a little bigger.
Yeah, so what we do is we have the original file. So we'll just kind of line up everywhere that it hits, overprint it by a little bit extra. So we got a little bit more to work with. Nice. And then we'll be able to just kind of like fold it in there, and it'll be perfect. There'll be no issue with it.
For a complicated car like this, it's looking awesome. And looks like you know what you're doing. So I figured I'd put a bunch of sawdust in the air too, and make it, yeah.
Yeah, it adds a little bit to the challenge of it, but you know, whatever. We're making it work. It really adds to the distress.
Yeah, it's turning out awesome. Yeah. Like, it looks like a brand new car. Like, really, if you don't look at all the rivets and stuff, but like the smoothness of it, you're like, oh, that actually looks really good.
I think your decision to go with the satin finish as opposed to a high gloss finish for it really, really adds to that.
And you got a lot of stuff going on, so you don't see the imperfections that much. But it's looking awesome. Very cool. That's it for today. You're coming back tomorrow?
Coming back tomorrow.
Sounds good.
With the extra prints. And,
well, if you come between 8 in the morning and 5 at night, I'll still be cutting sawdust.
Okay. Try not to be here at 4 again.
If you want, if you're here at 4 in the morning and work till 8, then that should be good.
We'll see. We'll see. We'll be right back. Okay, so because of this hood, it's bigger than the 60-inch maximum print width that we can do. We had to seam it somewhere. So, you know, both width and lengthwise, it was over 60. So we could either seam it across the center of it or up from the front bumper. So we decided to do it across the center. So when you're seaming something, you kind of have to line it up against, you know, where each piece is gonna line up, or both pieces are gonna line up. So for this, we're just gonna line it up on this red mark. That's where we're actually gonna be cutting and overlapping the other piece. And then lining up against this tape line, so we know on both sides this is gonna be lined up there. So when we peel it back, flip it over, cut it off the backing paper, we know that's gonna line up perfectly. So this tool is actually really useful. Basically what it is it's a double-edged blade, and it'll cut the backing paper in a little strip so you have a tack mark. And then you can just take this piece out. You can see you got the little tack line there, it's about an inch wide. And then that means when you place the material, it's still exactly where it's supposed to be. You can just tack it down and then take both sides of the backing paper off really quickly and really easily. And you know that it lines up perfectly. So then we just tack it. And that should be good to go on both sides. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're just gonna be putting on a windshield banner here. So easiest way to do this is just, you know, you make your tape marks on either side. If you're gonna give a curve to it, you usually wanna plot that out, but we're just gonna do a straight cut across the bottom. So there's this really cool stuff called knifeless tape. So basically what it is, it's a tiny little filament inside a very thin piece of tape, and that allows you to get a perfectly clean straight edge when you go to lay the vinyl without having to, you know, cut on paint. So this stuff is super useful. So what I'm gonna do here, just give yourself a little bit extra and I'll show you. It looks really cool when you do it. So we have a plain piece of satin black that we're gonna put across the banner, right? So instead of trying to get a nice straight cut by hand, what you do is you just slap this on wherever, and that little tape mark, that filament will run underneath. And off the end here, you just pull it through the material and then it'll get a nice perfectly straight edge. Doing it on glass is actually really nice because glass is always the smoothest part.
Yeah.
Right? So you don't even have to worry about like wrinkles or anything like that.
30-year-old scrapyard car.
A fender with a couple of different. Okay, so we'll go through and like tuck those edges afterwards, but I'll just show you how the knifeless tape works because it's like the coolest thing ever. Whenever I do it, people are always like, "Oh, that's so cool! Do it again." So I'll show you. Do it again. So all you really have to do, you got this little bit of extra tail here, right? So you cut off just enough to make sure that you can see it. Push it on so it's nice and stuck. And then you grab the filament, rip it. And then this little pink filament you see here, that's how it's actually gonna cut through the vinyl. So when you pull it, you can see, perfect cut. So what you do, it's pretty awesome. Actually, Rich, if you wanna finish it off.
I do.
So you grab that and just keep on pulling right across. And then up over the edge. And then grab this, perfectly clean edge. And then these last little tiny little bits of tape, you just grab those, pull those off, let you get those out. And then just my tape guide that I had laid down earlier. And there you go, you got a perfectly smooth edge. There we go. Now we know that logo, that's where the center is supposed to be.
Okay.
So that's at 51 and a quarter. So 50 and a quarter. Let me just divide that in half. And that goes there. And that'll be our center line. So there's a little bit of the more janky way of doing this. You usually want to use pre-mask, but when you don't have any, masking tape works fine. And then we'll know to put that against the laser line. Okay. Rich, would you mind helping me here real quick? So we're just gonna put that on the center. Now, the bottom of garage goes to here. So I'm gonna keep it roughly even between that, the bottom there, that and the top. I'm just gonna use like a finger's width there. Now you're gonna have to come towards me just a little bit. Okay, that's good. Thank you.
100 times better. You do good work, man.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. And I know it's frustrating because it's a very complicated car. You've got welds, you've got corners going in and down, you've got moldings that's actually structural to the car, you've got holes in the doors, you got rust and like paint missing, but it looks fantastic. And you can appreciate the work because I don't know whether you did it on purpose or not, but just say you did.
I will.
Yeah, because we were going with the Group B bumper, and this, I still gotta bolt this back on again, but it's late and I wanna go to bed. But it's coming up and then the stripe kind of carries it through. But something about with the wrap on it, now the bumper looks shorter. It doesn't.
100%, yeah. Because I remember when we first walked in, like the bumper was huge. It stuck out so far on the front of the car. But I think breaking it up with so many different shapes and like the different colors and whatnot, it really shrinks it back. It doesn't look quite as big into your face out the front of it.
Yeah, right? Yeah. And then even stuff like putting the decal here, like halfway through the door handle, it kind of moves the door handle back.
Yeah. It like hides it a little bit too.
Yeah. Right?
Like you don't see the door handle
quite
as much.
And it shrinks the car a little bit. It's a very long car. So yeah, that's fantastic. But we are going to wrap this.
Yep. There's like one or two other little things I know you guys still want to do with it.
Okay. Because even that will shorten the car again a little bit too. Rather than this massive window, it'll just make the pillar bigger.
Yeah. It'll like hide that the glass there and like tie it in with the stripes, right?
That's
something that we're going to be redoing there. But I think overall, like, this is probably the project I've liked working on the most.
Yeah?
Because like it's unusual, right? Like I've wrapped a lot of cars, but none of them are like passion projects.
Right.
Like this is something where when I came to look at this car, I was like, wow, this is different, definitely. But it's like, it's your passion, right?
Right.
And like
right.
I was included into that, and that's what makes it special for me.
Did you lose sleep over it?
Very much so. Every day. Stayed up late, had to reprint stuff a couple of times, but you know, it's worth it. It's an unusual project.
When I work on the car, I lose sleep. I get into the car and I get so into it, I'm physically tired, I have to go in the house, and as soon as I close my eyes, it's like an exploded view of the car, and I cannot sleep.
Yep.
Like I physically have to walk away for like days, and then I can get a good night's sleep, then I can go back on it again. But
it was those vents, that's what I was losing sleep
for. Oh yeah.
That was the unusual piece.
Oh, surprise! Yeah. You brought your wrap, buddy.
Well, because you changed this on me like the night before, remember? So.
Well, yeah, you didn't show up on Wednesday, and Wednesday night I went to Aaron. I'm like, yeah, I think, you know, if I put a massive dent in the door, we can get more air in there. He's like, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah,
so it was Aaron's fault.
It's my punishment for being a day late. I accept that. That's okay. Yeah, no, I love it.
And that's how the car is being built. It's just one more idea put on top of another, on top of another.
Why don't we try
But that? This is a huge jump towards, man, this is freaking awesome. Yeah.
No, I think this looks great.
Yeah.
I'm super happy with it. I hope you guys are too.
Yeah, yeah, we're going to get you to do the Mustang, and maybe we'll do some cool stuff with the workbenches in the corner. But that's all later. You're... Mississauga?
Yeah, so out in Mississauga. So my name's Ian Riddell. I've been wrapping cars for about 4 years now. So if you want to hit me up, I'm on Instagram as Ian Riddell. And yeah, love to work on some cool projects.
Right on.
Rich, thank you so much.
Yeah.
I really appreciate it. Thank
you
so much for this opportunity.
Thanks, guys. More stuff coming on the Audi yet. There's still, as you notice, the scoop is gone. So we're actually going to get Ian back because we're going to cut a big hole in this roof and put a scoop in the front. But before we do that, we want to take it to the dyno. It's winter time now. It did well on the track, but we need to tune it, and we need to get better at tuning. So that'll be in the next videos. Here we go. I'm standing in front of the cat because I want you guys to know that while we're working on the Audi, I'm also working on the GTO and we're working on the cat. Lots of progress being done. So that video will be coming up real soon. I know you guys are jonesing hard for the truck, and I got good news. All my trucks are broken, so if we have any chance of actually driving anywhere this year, I need to finish this one, so the rush is on. The Audi's in good shape, GTO's in good shape, but anyway, back to the car show.
we were the first ones to host the largest global international car show. It was a massive success. We had over 1,200 submissions of your project cars that were awesome, absolutely incredible. We had a $1,000 grand prize. We had half a dozen YouTubers judging different categories. This year, we want to go twice as big, at least, meaning that grand prize is $2,000. We're going to throw in a pile of giveaways from companies that we work with. We've got our web designer on standby in case the site crashes again, because you guys are so awesome. And we're having twice as many judges. That's right, 12 or 13. We're gonna have a lot of judges, and we added a pile of other categories. If you felt left out because your homemade plane wasn't in some specific category, you're in luck. So currently we have 14 YouTube channels judging your projects, and we thought, you know what? Just for fun, let's flip it around. Have one more category where you guys judge YouTube channels. And this is the Gearhead Choice Award. If you have a YouTube channel, or you know of somebody who has a YouTube channel that is doing a really cool build, but maybe needs a little bit more recognition or has a pile of recognition already, we're letting you guys be the judges on this one rather than the other way around. It doesn't matter how many subs. If they have a cool project, you have a cool project, you want a little bit more recognition, we want to look at how you make your videos. So link your videos, definitely pictures and videos of your build. We want to get you guys out in front of a whole new crowd. On top of that, if you win your category, Aaron and I are freeing up our services to help you out. If you want, you don't have to. We can give you some behind the scenes on the business aspect of it, networking with companies, figure out what your goals are for your channel. Is it to become full-time? Is it to just finance a build that you're doing? You'll also be a builders tier member off of our website that gives you discounts to all of the companies that we've partnered with. So there's a lot of cool perks involved with that as well. We thought, you know what, another great way to give a little boost to somebody who deserves it, and hopefully that's you or the channel that you're thinking of.
So you're probably wondering how to submit your rides by now watching this awesome video. So you gotta go to
internationalcarshow.com
and tell us about it. Tell us some details, tell us a story. Was it your grandpa's car? Did you inherit it? Did you buy it? Did you always want it? Tell us about the modifications. We need to know to be able to judge it. Don't just send us some pictures of your mom's minivan and say, it's a minivan. What do you think? You can submit it into as many categories as you want. Just be mindful of what judges are judging those categories and what they'll probably look for. Okay, guys? You got 2 weeks.
Do it.
So once you've submitted your car, there's gonna be a 1 week voting period. Get your buddies to get on the website and vote for your car, and then 24 others, because you get 25 votes and the cream will rise to the top. So once the voting's done, the top 25 in each category will go to our fabulous judges and they will pick their favorite. And from there, we will decide the Mega Balls. That lucky son of a bee will get 2 G's in gift cards to Summit? Yeah, Summit. Lucky bugger.
Check out the car show. The link is down below. And check out all the other projects while you're there. The really cool thing is that there's a story behind most of them. Just a nice way to get motivated to build your own stuff. So remember, if you're not filthy, you're not rich, get out there and work on it after you submit it to the car show. Here we go.